everyone. My name is Katie Connell, and I'm in the Department of Sociology, and it is my pleasure to welcome you tonight to the 6th Annual Eve Kosofsky Sedgwick Memorial Lecture. Let's see. Sorry, I already lost my place. The stress of these things, you know? Sorry. So it's wonderful to see so many of you here this evening, especially in these kind of gloomy conditions. We really appreciate that you've come out tonight. It's my job just to give a quick introduction to the group that's hosting and who originally created this lecture series, and then my colleague Jennifer Rowe will come up and give an introduction specifically for our speaker that we're so happy to be hearing from tonight, Professor Roderick Ferguson. The Sedgwick Lecture is run by a group of faculty here at BU who are interested in reading work in gender and sexuality studies across disciplines, and we've been doing so since 2007. The name of the group is the Boston University Gender and Sexualities Studies Group. Eve Sedgwick, for those of you who may not know, was one of queer theory's founders, and we're very proud to claim taught here at BU in the 1980s. Upon hearing of her passing in 2009, the members of the BU Gender and Sexuality Studies Group wanted to do something to get together to honor what an incredible legacy Sedgwick left behind. We organized a conference in spring of 2009 called Honoring Eve and invited 13 speakers to come and share their thoughts and memories about Eve and her work. It was a great success, attended by over 250 people coming from around the globe to celebrate and to think critically about Eve's contributions. And in fact, it was such a great success that we decided to inaugurate this annual conference in her honor. If you go to bu.edu/honoringeve, you can see not just the archives from that original conference, but also videos of all of the past lectures, save one. So you can see the lectures from Henry Abeloff, Anthony Parker, Janet Halley, and Saba Mahmoud, and we've also hosted Lauren Berlant for one of our annual lectures. We are absolutely thrilled then to have Roderick Ferguson to deliver our 6th, and before I pass the mic on to Jenny to tell you a little bit more about Professor Ferguson's work, just a few quick thank yous. First off, thank you to the Gender and Sexuality Studies Group for the great work you've done putting this event together, and especially to my co-organizer this year, Jennifer Rowe, who you'll be hearing from soon. Thanks to Christine Loken Kim for her assistance, and of course to the BU Center for the Humanities. Without their assistance, we would not be able to deliver this amazing annual event. I'd also like to thank our co-sponsors, the Program in Women's Gender and Sexuality Studies, the Department of English, the Department of Modern Languages and Comparative Literature, the Department of American Studies, the School of Theology, the Department of Romance Studies, and the Department of Sociology. So you can see, you know, what an interdisciplinary reach Professor Ferguson's work has and how excited we are to have him here today. Finally, I want to thank Anthony Lee for the amazing poster design that no doubt lured many of you into tonight's event. And I just have a couple quick announcements before I pass things on to Jennifer. First, we're going to have a Q&A after the lecture, and because we're recording, we're going to ask you to speak into a microphone for your questions. There will be two mic runners, so just raise your hand and someone will come to you with that mic. And for undergraduates and graduates in the audience, we're having a student conversation tomorrow about the lecture and about how it interacts with our own work and scholarly interests in the Center for Gender, Sexuality, and Activism, which is in the basement of the George Sherman Union. And that will be at 1 p.m. and includes free food. So I hope to see some of you there. And thank you. Welcome.
And I think we need a second round of applause for Katie Connell. She was amazing and has done so much work organizing this talk today. My name is Jennifer Rowe. I'm an assistant professor of French here at BU. And I'm going to do a small introduction to the work of Rod Ferguson. So from the murders of trans people of color to the aggressions, both macro and micro, experienced by sexual and racial minorities alike, the proliferation of tragedies that flash daily across the news headlines or enabled by the bombastic rhetoric of politicians has revealed a pervasive and insidious kind of violence. This is a violence leveled against certain kinds of bodies, those of nonconforming genders, those of diverse religious faiths, those Black, Indigenous, or Latina, those touched by disabilities. It has become clear that an attention to sexuality, feminist thought, and queer critique is necessarily imbricated with the study of these precarious lives, to borrow a term from Judith Butler, yoked by fragile or intense intimacies, shimmering between visibility and erasure. The Gender and Sexuality Studies group, affectionately nicknamed GenSex, turned to the work of Rod Ferguson to help us think through these sites of fragility and power. Ferguson, along with the late Jose Esteban Yunos, can truly be considered one of the pioneers of queer or color critique. This is an understanding of race and sexuality that is not merely additive. In other words, instead of simply tacking on considerations of racialized bodies and identities to a pre-existing queer theory, Ferguson strove to develop a queer of color critique through a different vein. He shows how even a category as supposedly neutral as sexuality is itself formed through particular racialized and capitalist investments. It becomes therefore impossible to think of sexuality and queer analysis without considering the ways that the simple notion of sexuality itself is constructed by whiteness. In 2004, Ferguson's Aberrations in Black broke innovative new ground by taking up the silence as a Marxist thought. The uncritical and naturalized ways that categories such as labor and value are established, and he revealed how specific ideologies of race, gender, and class rushed in to fill the silences. One of his most powerful passages shows how the African-American queer subject, quote, demands resistance to interpolation. He says, the queer of color subject can both trace the workings of interpolation and inspire other subjects to defy its operation. While canonical formations promise normalcy to the racialized non-white subject, the queer of color subject reminds us that such promises are techniques of discipline rather than vehicles for liberation. To the GenSex group, this passage served as such a powerful reminder of the ways that additive inclusion is not enough to contest the pre-existing pathways of agency. Not only is additivity insufficient, but the queer of color also importantly shatters the very fantasy of liberation from such sedimented set structures of visibility and normalcy. Another aspect of Ferguson's work that I personally admire, and an aspect I think would have appealed to Sedgwick herself, is Ferguson's ability to blend together women of color feminist theory and queer of color critique. This is a significant move insofar as queer thought and feminist thought have at times been uneasy bedfellows, sharing a genealogical source, but engaged in a love-hate relationship over the contested nature of difference. As opposed to considering one nature of difference as taking priority over another, Ferguson has been consistently engaged with the coalitional possibilities of queer and feminist of color thought, an engagement that he extends in his volume, Strange Affinities, the Gender and Sexual Politics of Comparative Racialization, co-edited with Grace Hong. Finally, in his 2012 Reorder of Things, The University and Pedagogies of Minority Difference, he examines what might be termed the domestication of difference, how power purports to incorporate difference and diversity while simultaneously, quote, refining and perfecting its practices of exclusion and regulation. Taking the institution of the university as his object of study, Ferguson showed how power operates not centrally or in a top-down imposition, but rather through the establishment of approved pressure valves of dissent or acceptable representation. In the age of the glib diversity statement or the rainbow-perfect college campus brochure, it is not enough to tout inclusion while still shying away from more dynamic stances or what he calls a, quote, redistributive valorization of minority difference and culture. It is for these reasons, his foundational theorizing so crucial to queer of color analysis, his commitment to queer and feminist theory alike, and his larger critique of institutions ranging from the discipline of canonical sociology to the university itself, that Rod Ferguson has been such a powerful voice in feminist, queer, and critical race scholarship. Ferguson has been professor of African American and Gender and Women's Studies at the University of Illinois, Chicago since 2014, where he also co-directs the Racialized Body Research Cluster. His research has earned numerous awards and fellowships, including the MLA Crompton Knoll Award for Best Essay in LGBTQ Studies for his essay, The Parvenu Baldwin and the Other Side of Redemption. Prior to the University of Illinois, he was formerly a professor and chair of the Department of American Studies at the University of Minnesota. Ferguson is also an active editor, having previously served as the associate editor of the American Studies Association flagship journal, American Quarterly, and currently as a series editor of the University of Minnesota Press's Difference Incorporated series. Ferguson will be sharing work today that is part of a larger book project on Black queer diasporic art and activism in the 70s and 80s. Thank you for joining us today, and please join me in welcoming Roderick Ferguson, the 6th Annual Eve Sedgwick Memorial Lecture Speaker, whose talk today is entitled The Diasporas of Black Queer Art.
People can hear me? All right, great. All right, first I'd like to thank all the sponsors of tonight's event for the honor of this invitation. Thank you all for coming out. Like many people, Eve Sedgwick was the first queer studies scholar and theorist that I ever read and indeed ever knew about. Her interest in sexuality as an epistemological question has always been generative and inspiring to me. If I had to find myself in one of her passages, it would be this one from her chapter, Queer and Now, in her 1993 book, Tendencies. A lot of the most exciting recent work around queer spins the term outward along dimensions that can't be subsumed under gender and sexuality at all. The ways that race, ethnicity, post-colonial nationality crisscross with these and other identity-constituting, identity-fracturing discourses, for example. Intellectuals and artists of color whose sexual self-definition includes queer, I think of an Isaac Julian, a Gloria Anzaldúa, a Richard Fung, are using the leverage of queer to do a new kind of justice to the fractal intricacies of language, skin, migration, state. Thereby, the gravity, I mean the gravitas, the meaning, but also the center of gravity of the term queer itself deepens and shifts, end quote. So in the spirit of leveraging queer for dimensions within and outside of sexuality, I'd like to invite you on an imaginative exercise that tries to deepen and shift the gravity of queerness once again. Dream, if you will, of a bookshop, one with bookcases and built-ins. The places that are absent of books are filled with works of art on the sides of shelves whose only purpose seems to be as canvases for pictures, paintings, and African masks. Above the fireplace that greets visitors as they come through the front entrance, and in general, on any spot not already occupied. There are even paintings and photographs stacked upright on the floor. But one notices that while this bookshop bears resemblance to others of its kind, this store is undeniably devoted to the literatures and arts of Black people throughout the diaspora. Our bookshop is in the tradition of other Black bookshops like Essawan Books in Los Angeles, California, Pyramid Books in Washington, D.C., the Shrine of the Black Madonna in Atlanta, Georgia, Bogo Livolture, New Beacon, Head Start, Unity, all of which were in London, and many, many more. Some of the bookshops are still here, but many of them are gone, coming about as they did as literary and cultural arms of the Black Power movement. They were tied to organizations like the Universal Colored People's Association and the Black People's Alliance in Britain. Bogle Livolture even served as a publishing house in its own right, publishing classic texts such as Walter Rodney's How Europe Underdeveloped Africa in 1972, as well as several of the works by the poet and novelist Andrew Salkey. While our bookshop is part of this tradition of Black bookshops, it is also different. Our bookshop is complete with books and art by Black feminists and queer authors and artists. Unlike its predecessors, our bookshop emerged in the moments in which we had to reckon with the gender and sexual exclusions of Black nationalism, as well as the violences of the state. In those moments where we realized that Massa's Day was in fact not done, that it had been brought back to life through sexist and homophobic policies and practices from folks who we presume to be our brothers and sisters. Our bookshop holds, therefore, the memories of our disappointments, as well as the seeds of our dreams for liberation. The Black Bookshop is a metaphor for the role that aesthetic production has played in Black queer diasporic art and activism. That is, as the site for witnessing biopolitics and necropower, and as the location for experimenting with the possibilities of autonomous modes for disrupting powers, aims, and confidence. There's a first edition copy of Audre Lorde's 1986 anthology, Our Dead Behind Us, in the bookshop. It's prominently displayed on a Gibson holder that sits on one of the tables. The book has been read, but it's in good condition. Scuff marks peek from the edge of the binding, but even still, there are no holes or tears. The book shows some underlining and note-taking on the pages, but there are no inscriptions by the previous owner to hinder your enjoyment. You turn to the poem, Equal Opportunity. The American Deputy Assistant Secretary of Defense for Equal Opportunity and Safety is a homegirl. Blindness slashes our tapestry to shreds. The moss green military tailoring sets off her color beautifully. She says, "When I stand up to speak in uniform, you can believe everyone takes notice." Superimposed, skull-like across her trim, square shoulders, dioxin smear, the stench of napalm upon growing cabbage, the chug and thud of corsairs in the foreground, advanced like a blush across her cheeks, up the unpaved road, outside Greenville, Grenada. Lorde wrote the poem a year after the US invasion of Grenada. In her essay, Grenada Revisited, an interim report first published in the Black Scholar in 1984, Lorde argued that the invasion of Grenada invoked other military incursions. Quote, "The Pentagon has been spoiling for a fight it could win for a long time. The last one was the battle for Incheon in the 1950s. How better to wipe out the bitter memories of Vietnamese defeats by yellow people than with the restoration of power in the eyes of the American public, the image of American Marines splashing through a little black blood," end quote. And as she stated in an anti-apartheid address from the 1980s, Grenada recalls other forms of violence legitimated by state officials, from the bombing of the MOVE headquarters in Philadelphia by Mayor Wilson Good's administration to the violence of the apartheid government in South Africa. As it focuses on the invasion, the poem tries to capture the biopolitical contours of state practices in the 80s. The phrase equal opportunity is lifted out of its civil rights context and is turned into a security matter, and in doing so, uses the lexicon of civil rights to justify the expansion of the state's repressive arm. In his discussion of biopower, Michel Foucault writes that biopower needed, quote, "the controlled insertion of bodies into the machinery of production and the adjustment of the phenomena of population to economic processes," end quote. Foucault goes on to say that biopower also required both the availability and docility of bodies and populations to, quote, "have methods of power capable of optimizing forces, aptitudes, and life in general without at the same time making them more difficult to govern," end quote. In the poem, the Deputy Assistant Secretary's racial and gender difference are inserted into the state's production of war and security, making her racial and gender difference into the state's ensign. Her life is thus optimized according to the state's security and governmental needs. The theorist Achille Mbembe builds on and challenges Foucault's notion of biopolitics. Necropower, he argues, quote, "accounts for the various ways in which, in our contemporary world, weapons are deployed in the interest of maximum destruction of persons and the creation of death worlds," end quote. In the poem, the Black woman, whose life has been selectively enhanced by the state, enables the maximum destruction visited on Grenada, making her not only a symbol of biopolitics, but of necropower as well. Her suit is both a symbol of the forced complementarity between her Blackness and the military-industrial complex, acting as the trace of war's theater, specifically the use of the herbicide Agent Orange as a tactic of counterinsurgency. In Mbembe's language, her pride of race and gender legitimates the death worlds created in the names of society and its defense. As a poem that engages the simultaneity of the deputy's hegemonic affirmation and the state's necropolitical violence, Equal Opportunity joins forces with an observation by the Colombian artist Doris Salcedo. She states, quote, "I believe war is the main event of our time. War is what defines our lives, and it creates its own laws. War forces us to generate some ethical codes in which we exclude a whole part of the population once they do not fit into our ethical code. Then we can attack them and destroy them because they are not human. So it's a tool to expel people from humankind," end quote. Equal Opportunity points to the constant state of war that has come to define human life. Here is the poem again. "Beside the shattered water pipe down road, Granny Lou's consolations. If it was only kill they'd wanted to kill we, many more would have died. Look at Lebanon. So as wars go, this was an easy one. But for we here, who never woke up before to see planes shitting fire into chimney, it was a damn awful lot," end quote. While the poem begins with the ethical problem of the black woman's racial and gender difference as the vehicle by which the state's violence is legitimated, the poem begs the question of what does it mean for a black lesbian poet mother to make the expansion of security and state violence into a black lesbian issue. By implicitly asking the question, Lord expands the parameters of what counts as the critical work of black, queer, and feminist modes of difference. There, in the bookshop, you ponder Lord's innovation, how the question that she asked, "Are you doing your work?" requires us to combine various spaces of inquiry. With an eye toward this, the French theorist Jacques Rancière has famously re-theorized the notion of the aesthetic to address the expanding parameters of what can be known under the aesthetic regime, writing, quote, "The aesthetic regime disrupts the apportionment of spaces," end quote. Through this argument, he produced a powerful rebuttal to Plato. In The Politics of Aesthetics, for example, he argues that Plato, via Socrates, condemns the mimetician for being, quote, "a double being," end quote, for doing two things at once and thereby violating the rational organization of society and knowledge, an organization that depends upon a division and a specialization of labor. Rancière then reads the mimetician as the worker who brings his or her work and his or her know-how not only to the private sphere where they presumably belong, but also conducts them in the public sphere where they do not. In doing so, the mimetician worker violates the sensible distribution of where work and know-how should take place, thereby redistributing the sensible allocation of work and its spaces. But there is another figure in Plato's Republic that violates the specialization of work and knowledge as well, one that, for our purposes, might prove more useful. Here I'm talking about the satyr, Marsyas, who was flayed for defying the god Apollo in a musical contest, Marsyas's double reed pipe to Apollo's lyre. The difference between Apollo's lyre versus Marsyas's double reed pipe for Socrates is that it is most appropriate for civic life because it more closely, quote, "imitates the voice and accents of a brave man in a time of war," end quote, and because it apparently adheres to only a single mode. Thus, the lyre, as an instrument, distinguished itself from the many-stringed double reed played by Marsyas, an instrument unnatural in that it can accommodate many modes and is thus an extension of the unnatural, indecent, and queer satyr, who assumes both the mode of the human and that of the animal. Marsyas violates specialization, and his violation is understood to be part of his non-normative difference. In this way, he is most akin to the black queer artist and intellectual who insists on the many-moded representation of society, the one who violates the decency of disciplinarity and politics. Marcius is preferable to the mimetician because the history of Black queer aesthetics invokes how the violation of specializations and divisions in certain contexts is a non-normative violation, replete with differences of race, gender, and sexuality. We might recognize Lord's interest in the simultaneity of modes of power as an interest in the reapportionment of disfranchising contexts and spaces. The poem's version of intersectionality might be read, therefore, as an effort to apprehend how dominant modes of power reapportion spaces of repression, causing them to overlap and interlock. The bookshop is quiet. Jazz is playing softly throughout the store. You come back to the poem. The American Deputy Assistant Secretary of Defense for Equal Opportunity and Safety pauses in her speech, licks her dry lips. As you can see, the department has a very good record for equal opportunity for our women. She swims towards safety through a lake of her own blood. In addition to the books, there are paintings and photographs. Some of the paintings rest on easels situated throughout the bookshop. Paintings and photographs are hung on the bookcases themselves. Others are planted along the walls. You recognize one of the photographs as that of the Nigerian British queer artist Rotimi Fanny Coyote. The photograph is entitled Dennis Carney and Essex Hemphill in Brixton. On the surface, the photograph depicts a Black British activist, Carney, and an African-American poet and activist, Hemphill, in an embrace. But the photograph is also about Black queer diaspora and the material and ideological conditions that have occasioned it. Fanny Coyote was born in Nigeria to a prominent Yoruba family. At the age of 12, he and his family would flee to Britain because of the outbreak of the Nigerian Civil War, a war that was, to a degree, the result of the Igbos in the southeastern region of the country voting in 1967 to declare an independent Igbo state called the Republic of Biafra. Ideologically, the secession of the southeastern territory and the establishment of Biafra were motivated by the discourse of national self-determination. The proclamation of Biafra in 1967 stated, for example, quote, "The desire on the part of the minority groups for self-determination is the active force behind the demand for the creation of more states," end quote. The proclamation went on to locate Biafran independence in the, quote, "heroic struggles of all peoples all over the world for their national freedom," end quote. The Nigerian state's response would be protracted and brutal. For 2.5 years, Nigeria's federal military government would wage a war backed by the British and the Soviet Union on the breakaway republic. The opposing forces would produce a blockade that would result in the deaths of over 1 million people through fighting and planned starvation. For many, this would be the end of the post-colonial dream. Knowing this history is not only important for Fanny Coyote's personal biography, but for the biography of Black queer diaspora and its aesthetics as well, I think. To begin with, the imagined community of Black queer diaspora emerged when certain cultural presumptions lost their axiomatic grip. The first of these was the idea that the nation-state form could provide sufficient accommodations for the heterogeneous groups within a society. The Nigerian Civil War, for many, put that notion to rest. The second was that national liberation would automatically produce political and ideological alternatives to bourgeois and Western state nationalisms. As Cornel West argued in The New Cultural Politics of Difference, quote, "One crucial lesson of the decolonization process remains the manner in which most third world authoritarian bureaucratic elites deploy essentialist rhetorics about homogeneous national communities and positive images in order to repress and regiment their diverse and heterogeneous populations," end quote. The third was that heteropatriarchy is the natural and indigenous order for any functioning non-Western society. M. Jackie Alexander, Gayatri Gopinath, Chandra Mohanty, and others have written about the ways in which heteropatriarchy was naturalized through colonial laws and then sustained through post-colonial legislative maneuvers. There, in the bookshop, you consider ways to situate the photograph within this history of diaspora. While gazing at it, you think to yourself how anti-colonial and anti-racist liberation helped to generate agendas of freedom and individuation for a whole host of subjects. In the historiography of anti-colonialism, we typically narrate the desire for social change as one that took place among social movements, but there is every reason to believe that movement desires created series of subjective desires organized to produce different forms of racial, gender, and erotic autonomies, making the desire for self-determination move beyond the question of existing territories. As historian Brad Simpson argues, the Nigerian Civil War was in part the federal military government's response to the Biafran attempt to expand the definition of self-determination, expanding it in such a way that it applied not only to existing territories, but to ethnic groups as well. You could read the photograph then as the result of such an attempt also, interpreting the embrace as an erotic right to self-determination, as a comment about self-determination's potential to engender and signify revolutions that take place at the levels of the body and subjectivity. Rather than following one route, that of the nation's independence and liberation, the discourse of self-determination during the post-World War II period dispersed itself among a variety of discontinuous planes, from that of decolonized nation states to the racial and ethnic identities of Black diasporic subjects and to the body's possibilities for racial, gender, and sexual emancipation. On the credenza, beneath the photo, is a copy of the now defunct British Cultural Studies and Photography magazine, 10-8. This particular issue is called Critical Decade and seems to refer to the decade out of which the photograph emerges. The introduction reads, "Critical Decade tells us about the capacity of Black people to remake themselves historically, to become modern people, and to enter that most modern of all domains, the domain of representation. Not as the bearers of somebody else's discourse, but in their own right as historical subjects. This is why the question of identification, reiterated so often during the 80s, is so significant. It points to the capacity of people who have been objectified throughout history and suppressed as subjects to enter their own subjectivity and to put themselves in the frame." End quote. You also notice that the photograph is reproduced in Fanny Cuyode's and Alex Hirst's 1988 book, Schwarz Weiss. You open the first pages and read the dedication. "For Tony, the spirit of the clubhouse, Washington, D.C." Something is clarified. Since 1975 and for 12 years afterwards, the clubhouse, both a community center and a dance club, was the center of Black queer life in D.C. The staff at the clubhouse, it seemed, had one mission and one mission alone, quote, "to have the party you never had at your house," end quote. On any given night, you could hear Billy Griffin's "Hold Me Tighter in the Rain," Howard Johnson's "So Fine," and Evelyn Champagne King's "I'm in Love." The book, the clubhouse, and the photograph are part of a network of memories involving the overlaps between aesthetics, politics, and culture in a decade shaped by the necropolitical ravages of HIV/AIDS. As Helen Molesworth argues in her introduction to the book, this will have been art, love, and politics of the 1980s, quote, "Much of the art of the 1980s was involved in a shared project of expanding our understanding of identity and subjectivity, exploring the possibility of politics in a mediated public sphere, and offering increasingly nuanced and complicated versions of history and memory, end quote. Black queer diasporic community was created in this period, the artifact suggests, through shared spaces of activism, club cultures, and art. The book, the magazine, and the photograph also point to the ways that aesthetic production, friendship, sex, and dance were becoming essential ingredients for deploying pleasure as a challenge to emergent forms of necropower. Black queer diaspora was being articulated as a tactile and sensorial imagined community, precisely in the moment in which, as Mbembe argues, quote, technologies of destruction became more tactile, more anatomical and sensorial in a context in which the choice was between life and death, end quote. You've been in the bookshop for an hour and a half now. You're surprised that it's been that long. You note the curatorial sensibility that's evident through the collection of books and artwork that lines almost every space and every room. You realize that proprietors are no ordinary business people. To call them entrepreneurs seems like a vulgar reduction. There are enough signs, inscriptions on books showing varying degrees of use, and a couple of paintings held in frames that are slightly bent, that many of the texts and artworks were owned and held by prior hands. You slowly register the fact that the owners are themselves collectors. You think of what Walter Benjamin said in his essay, Unpacking My Library, quote, the period, the region, the craftsmanship, the former ownership for a true collector, the whole background of an item adds up to a magic encyclopedia whose quintessence is the fate of his object, end quote. It makes you think that this black queer bookshop is a microcosm for the encyclopedic nature of black diaspora. You see a book by the black queer Canadian writer Dion Brand on one of the bookshelves. It's a hardback. The cover has streaks of orange, green, blue, yellow, and brown on it. It occurs to you that it's most likely a painting of a landscape. The book is called Sans Souci and Other Stories, and sure enough, you can tell from the table of contents that the book is about the black diasporic landscape of Canada. Discussing that landscape, the black queer Canadian scholar and writer Ronaldo Walcott states in Black Like Who, writing Black Canada, quote, as a location for post-emancipation and post-national independence, for Caribbean migrants and continental African migrants, and as a sanctuary for escaping enslaved African Americans and their descendants, the multiplicities of blackness in Canada collide in ways that are instructive for current diasporic theorizing, end quote. Walcott underlines here the relational nature of black diasporic formations, that is, the various historical and regional contexts that bear upon and differentiate their constituencies. The short story, the third short story in the book, has an interesting title. Blossom, Princess of Oya, Goddess of Winds, Storms, and Waterfalls. It tells the story of the main character, Blossom, who comes to Canada from Trinidad in search of work. On the first page, you smile in recognition at the line, every once in a while, under she breath, she cursed the day she come to Toronto from Arapachi, Trinidad. You learn that Blossom's time in Canada is beset with betrayal and mistreatment from friends and lovers, as well as alienation from the jobs that she holds. Her story becomes an accumulation of alienations, economic and social, in fact, until finally she concludes in despair, living wasn't just for slaving, and it seemed that in this society, the harder you work, the less you have. One night, Blossom is possessed by the Yaruba Orisha of change, Oya, and dreams of a battle that she has with the spirit called suffering. Initially, Blossom is so diminished by suffering's attack that she loses her hair and her fingernails until only one grain of she left. After calling on Oya to seemingly no avail, She roll and dance, she grain self into a hate so hard. She chisel she self into a hard, sharp prickle and fly in suffering face. After blossom spinning and chewing and dancing, suffering slams a door and disappears. We might read suffering as a metaphor for the alienations that take place on the axes of race, gender, labor, and sexuality in Black diasporic settings. We might then read it as the scene of self and institution making. Blossom's speakeasy house demonstrates something that seems to be constitutive about Black queer diasporic aesthetics, the rearticulation of gender and sexuality as the basis for producing new modes of subjective and institutional autonomy. As such, these aesthetics share a space with Rancière's understanding of the possibility of aesthetics in Western modernity. As he argues, quote, "The aesthetic revolution produced a new idea of political revolution, the materialization of a common humanity still only existing as an idea." There are more rooms to explore in the bookshop, and for all the time you've spent here, you've only seen this one. Other memories fill you: the Paradise Garage and Larry Levan, Kitchen Table Press and all the wonderful books that it midwifed into the world, the Black Nations, Queer Nations Conference in 1995, so on and so on. You wonder what other memories might rise up and take hold if you were to stay longer. It's not hard to resolve to come back, because you know that with each encounter between you and the objects therein, so much will be renewed. Thank you.
Well, this, can you hear me?
Mm-hmm.
Is that on? Okay. So I think part of why it feels hard to ask a question was that was just exquisite. So
oh, thank you.
Thank you. I'm a little bit taken, it's beautiful.
Thank you.
And so stimulating and interesting. And so this is a very, you know, literal-minded question in some ways, but I wonder about your use of the space of the bookstore as a defiant gesture in this moment. I wonder if you could talk about that, the bookstore and globalization.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, the local and the global is,
oh, yeah,
yeah.
Yeah, yeah,
yeah. So how'd you come to the bookstore?
To the bookshop.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, I came to the bookshop because I went to London in November of last year, and there were just two fabulous exhibits, art exhibits, that I saw. One was an exhibit by the Autolith Group there in London, you know, made up of Angelica Sargar and Kojo Ashun, you know, also cultural critics in their own right. But they put together an exhibit based on the Pan-Africanist art platform based in South Africa, the Chimurenga Library, right? And so the Chimurenga, that was my first encounter with the Chimurenga Library, actually. It is, you know, it's an artist platform, so they do many things. So they have a broadsheet that they publish four times a year called The Chronic. And everything having to do with, you know, globalization, you know, empire, neocolonialism, the racial state, prison expansion, you know, art and activism, transnational art and activism, it's in The Chronic. Right? You know, so one of the issues of The Chronic, in fact, you know, was devoted to an alternative imagining of maps of Africa, right? And so one map would be, you know, all of the arts organizations, you know, and where they're located in Africa. Another map would be where the drugs are coming to and where they're coming from as they enter Africa, okay, parts of Africa. They also have a radio station called Pan Africa Space Station. And they also produce like these little books, you know, that, you know, are even smaller than pocketbooks that are part memoir, part fiction as well. So that was one. And then there was an exhibit on the Bogle Le Vulture bookshop that I mentioned, right? That is now defunct, right? But it, you know, it was the, one of the centers of, you know, black life, cultural and radical life, you know, in London. And so what they did was to reproduce, this is another set of organizers, right? Reproduce parts of the bookshop in the gallery. Now, it's significant that the gallery is the Guildhall Gallery, the center of London administration, where Henry VIII was, and also where the Zong case, you know, the slaves who were dumped over for insurance purposes, was argued. Okay, and so you walk into one room and you see all of the books lying on the wall. You see some of the correspondence between the owners, husband and wife, Jessica and Eric Huntley in display cases. You also see some of the art that was in the bookshop, you know, there. You go into the other room and they reproduced, you know, as a facsimile, you know, the bookshop itself. So there's shelves with the books, and then there's an interactive, you know, console to show you the demonstrations that took place when the bookshops were bombed, you know, in the late 70s because of the rise of the National Front, you know. And, you know, one of the amazing things about it for me, you know, I went in there and I thought, oh, I don't know anything about this bookshop, right? And then I started to see books that I have, you know, Walter Rodney's, you know, How Europe Underdeveloped Africa, Andrew Salkey's Jamaica, you know, and I see, and it's like, oh my God, this is, I have a place here. And it also reminds me of the first black bookshop that I knew as a kid, and that was the Shrine of the Black Madonna in Atlanta, right? And so, you know, it became like this really sort of powerful, you know, moment of mnemonic moment, right, for me. And then I was saying to a friend that, you know, I think that maybe this is the key, you know, in terms of how to write this book, which I've been working on for like 2 or 3 years, right? I've been going to archives, I've been giving talks about it. It's never felt right until the idea of the bookshop. Part of the, you know, your question has to do with, you know, why the bookshop now, right? And I think that I was appreciating exactly what you're getting at in your question when I walked into that exhibit, right? The sort of, you know, ways in which the bookshop as an institution was, yeah, it was in capital, but it was also something extra capitalist about it, you know? In that, you know, they really were like these community centers. And there was also something, you know, artisanal about the way in which the owners would collect books and curate authors, you know, as if there was, you know, something very deep and historical about what they were doing, and they were conscious of it, you know, artisanal in that way. And so I wanted to figure out a way to, you know, have that sensorium, you know, as part of the writing of the book and the sense experience for the reader in the book, that, you know, there are layers and layers and layers of history and emotions, but also literacies, you know, here, that it really is about like, oh, I remember when I bought that book, you know? I remember what that book did for me then, and let me read it again, and like, oh, it's, I'm a new person now, and all this other stuff is coming at me, you know, that wasn't there when I read it before, you know? So, you know, so it's important for me to sort of figure out a way to, you know, note in the writing the sort of moment of discovery of these objects, and also of the art, you know, too. I'm an art collector, and so, you know, there is a way in which when what Benjamin says about the relationship that the owner has to he's talking about books and I'm packing my library, but he says the it's the renewal of the old. And, you know, and that applies to art, you know, as well, to visual art. So that's a long-winded answer to.
I felt it. Everything you said, I felt.
Okay, cool. Okay. Yeah, sure.
Hi, thank you so much for your talk. Mm-hmm. I just want to echo how beautifully constructed I thought it was.
Thank you.
And my question is about your point regarding the importance of pleasure, mm-hmm. the sensorial, mm-hmm. tactile
yeah.
pleasure
oh,
as
yeah.
a challenge to necropower.
Mm-hmm.
And I was wondering where you see that operating
mm-hmm.
and you know its relationship to what you've just discussed about the space of the bookshop
mm-hmm.
and
mm-hmm.
the way that you... describe the materiality of the
yeah.
text that you're discussing and creating this real sensorial experience,
yeah, yeah.
particularly given, you know, this is an audience where many of us probably experience that as a very pleasurable thing, encountering, you know, these types of artifacts.
Uh-huh.
But also, what about the sort of temporality of that?
Uh-huh.
So the idea, you know, of the bookstore moment being over, and also these materials, you know, some of your descriptions evoke the fragility of the materials themselves.
Mm-hmm.
And as someone who works on a very much earlier period, the 18th century,
mm-hmm.
I always think about how much has been lost and of what's left,
yeah,
you know, how it's literally falling apart.
Right.
And so what does that say about this
yeah.
idea of pleasure as a challenge to necropower and the temporality of that, the idea of it being very maybe ephemeral and fleeting?
Yeah, totally. That's an excellent question. You know, I think like a few things come to mind that, you know, one is, you know, if you think about, for instance, something, you know, in Foucault's A History of Sexuality, Volume 1, where he talks about, you know, scientific sexualis, or something like that. But anyway, it's all about the sort of distancing of, you know, the rational observer from, you know, the very erotic nature of the encounter with, you know, the scientific moment, right? You know, with your object. And so part of what I want to do is to sort of take, you know, the archivist or the book lover, you know, or the art lover, and one, imagine those people as, you know, sort of, you know, analysts in their own right, right? But then also, you know, analysts for whom, you know, there is the exuberance of pleasure, you know, as you encounter the object of analysis, right? So one is a kind of pushback against, you know, a kind of metaphysics that has structured Western rational thought, you know, in terms of the observer's relationship with the object as, you know, being everything but, you know, erotic and sensitive, as only sort of distant and withdrawing, you know? So that's one. You know, the other thing that, I'm trying to remember the other parts of your question about time. Say that again, the temporality thing.
Well, the idea that, the sense that the bookstore that you...
Oh, yes, got it. Okay, got it, yeah. Okay. Yeah, you know, there's this part in... you know, Benjamin's Unpacking My Library, where he says, you know, that, you know, you take the old book, right? And it becomes renewed once you handle it, once you engage it, right? And even at the end of that essay, you know, he says that it is not then the collector whose identity and subjectivity and ego is confirmed by, you know, the possession of the books, but it's actually the books and all of their sort of possibilities are confirmed so that the collector then disappears, you know, into it. And so, you know, part of it, what interests me and what has always interested me, you know, in queer of color critique, you know, and, you know, the kind of way I like to do it, you know, and that is sort of like as a kind of archaeologist, is that how, you know, these old things come alive, you know, because there was one, you know, people were not talking about women of color feminism or Audre Lorde or reading like these old, you know, texts that had been in many ways consigned to the dustbin of history, you know? And so part of what I and others try to do is to say that no, there's a way to re-engage, you know, these texts that reawakens them and also us, you know? And so, refute, you know, the sort of temporal banishment, you know, of the object, right? And, you know, to say that, I mean, if you think here of like Roland Barthes, you know, argument in SZ, right? That like, you know, there are many, many ways to open to enter the text, right? And each entrance offers the possibility of a new kind of life for the text and stuff. And so that which is past can actually then become present and also future. You know, so that's a temporal engagement, you know, for me. I do believe, you know, in a deliberation on both politically and intellectually on the past and the future. Like, I do believe in that.
Thank you again so much for that talk. I was thinking about... When you were talking about the Shrine of the Black Madonna, growing up in Atlanta, my bookstore was Karis Books or More, and I had that same experience. Like, I have a place here. This is like a new home. And then maybe also think about heterotopias. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So the idea of the, you know, what Foucault calls the other spaces sort of anchor down normal society, and like whether it's the prison or the school or the cinema. And what I was thinking about maybe, and I'm not sure if you would want to elaborate on this idea, but is there something about the model of the bookstore and its assemblage that detours from something like maybe the museum or the library that doesn't have this archiving function, right? And in this sort of the gravity, as you said, this new center of gravity that assembles together, would you propose that to be a type of heterodiaspora? So the heterotopia of diaspora that you know sort of maybe constellates which had been sort of scattered or shattered. And I don't know how that, if you had thought about the bookstore as heterotopia or heterodiaspora.
Yeah, no, I mean, I like how you clarified it. I mean, that was my sense, right? That like the bookshop, you know, I remember, you know, to give you a story, right, that I think gets at this. I remember the first books that I ever bought from the Shrine of the Black Madonna, you know, and I was maybe 15. And I lived in, you know, for those who don't know, in a small town in Georgia, about an hour and 15 minutes south of Atlanta. So, and I remember I called the Shrine of the Black Madonna because I found its name in a book that one of the books that my aunt had given me for Christmas, which was actually Arnold Rampersad's first volume of the biography on Langston Hughes, right? And so I found the name, and I called the bookstore, and they sent me a catalog with a blue cover with one of those cheap, you know, plastic bindings that you could just pull off. So there were no pictures. You know, there were also no descriptions of the books. There were only the titles and the authors. And I remember just picking things because they sounded good, like the title, you know. The title sounded good. But so anyway, so I ended up picking this anthology of the Negritude Poets and Toni Morrison's Tar Baby, because I was like, oh, that's an interesting title. You know, I knew the folk tale. You know, I knew the folk tale, so I thought, oh, this must be an interesting novel, right? And I also got Joseph Harris's, I forget the name of it, but the historian Joseph Harris, Africanist, you know, sort of history of, you know, Africa in the pre-World War II period or something like that. And I remember how worldly I felt. You know, when I was a little country boy in Manchester, Georgia, but I was reading, you know, for the first time, like Bernard Dabie, you know, or like Aimé Césaire, Leopold Senghor. You know, I was, you know, and then also reading, you know, African history. And so I thought in that moment, in this small town in Georgia, that these other geographies are present. You know, like these other histories, you know, are present as well. I mean, you know, so it, That's something only a bookshop can do. Amazon can't do that for you. You know, like to go back to the point, Amazon will never be able to do that for you. You know, as a person, you know, and as a reader. And so, yes, part of what I want to do with this project and the reason that I've chosen the bookshop is precisely this, right? You know, if you sort of imagine a conversation or other books that might come from a book like this, you know, what might be the other sort of heterotopias of Black queer diaspora that other people might think about? Like for me, you know, with the Road to Me, Fanny Coyote, it's like, oh, okay, let me look at, you know, Biafra. But for some other person, it might be another object and, you know, an entirely different, you know, history, which for me is actually related to one of the things that I observed with the scholarship by many folks working with queer of color work, and that is an interest in exploring, you know, sort of the regional and historical specificities of forms of sexuality, you know? So in this instance, it is about then exploring, you know, the sort of, you know, all the facets that make up the sort of a Black queer kaleidoscope, you know? Diasporic kaleidoscope. But, you know, my kaleidoscope is gonna look different from somebody else's kaleidoscope, you know?
So my question's more, I think, in terms of, like, the identity aspect. Like, uh-huh. Also, I loved everything that you said, and it was beautiful and wonderful.
Thank you.
But in terms of the bookstore, it kind of allows all of these kind of intersections to exist without having a hierarchy and without, I guess, speaking over one another in any way. And you kind of get to access and renew all of these parts of your identity as well as pieces of history. And I was curious as to, on like the capitalist and identity side of it, how you view that in terms of like the commodification of queer, African-American, Black culture right now. I guess in a further way, like what happens when you leave the bookstore, so to speak? Like what happens when you have to go back out and either reprioritize your identity? Yeah, exactly. And kind of go through that motion and, sorry, my question doesn't sound nearly as intelligent, but kind of process that sort of prioritizing the facets of your identity in a way that you can't help but be, but also have be an act of defiance. Like, how do you kind of rectify that in terms of the bookstore, if that makes sense?
Yeah, you know, well, I mean, I think that for me, that was also the motivation for including that particular poem from Audre Lorde, right? Because it is a story about, you know, a kind of hegemonic affirmation. It's not necessarily happening through capital, per se. It's happening through the military-industrial complex, right? Where, like, deputies, you know, her identity is then, you know, sort of captured and used, you know, by the state, you know, especially in its sort of, in a neo-imperial campaign, you know, against Grenada, right? So I think that, you know, part of what the bookshop, the metaphor, you know, does for me is to get people to think about that, right? That, like, you know, now it's something I tried to get folks to think about in my last book, right? That, like, you know, there I was talking about it with the ethnic studies, the rise of the ethnic studies and also gender studies, like the affirmation of, you know, forms of minority difference, you know, not enough. You know, especially when you have, you know, social formations, state, capital, academy, that have figured that out, you know, that like, oh, you know, affirmation may be a way to hook you, you know? And so what would it mean, you know, to provide yet another sort of space that allows us to meditate on the difference between a kind of hegemonic affirmation, right? And a kind of subversive, a ruptural, you know, affirmation. And, you know, it also then requires, you know, a certain kind of method for writing about Black queer diasporic formations, right? That, you know, part of the question then has to be precisely the one that you've articulated. You know, it's not simply about, you know, telling people what the clubhouse was about. you know, and who was there and all the shapes and sizes, you know. It is also about asking the question of how do we think about the clubhouse or whatever, you know, to engage conversations around power, you know, so in that way, it is also about returning to, you know, kind of constitutive inquiry from Foucault, you know, with the history of sexuality. The history of sexuality is not the history of identities. You know, it's the history of, like, you know, power's articulation through sexuality. So let's ask it again in a different way, you know. In terms of what do you do, you know, when you leave the book house? Well, I mean, you know, think here again of what I just said about the end of Benjamin's essay, right? And how, you know, part of what he argues is that, you know, the collector, you know, who begins as a kind of autonomous or presumably autonomous subject, I own these books, you know, is then, you know, sort of claimed by the books themselves, right? You know, so that, you know, it is about, you know, letting the books, the knowledge, you know, the artwork and its sort of meditations around difference and power, you know, ingesting that so that, you know, when you leave the bookshop is still with you, you know? And, you know, I mean, because here's the thing. We all carry institutions with us, right? Even when we leave the academy, there's a bit of the academy that we take to bed at night. You know, the question is, which already means that, you know, part of our own sort of, you know, subjectivity has incorporated, you know, the institution. You know, how then to put other institutions there, you know, so that, like, we're not taking this thing, you know, with us, that we're taking other things. I mean, that was the thing about, like, what the art exhibit on Bogle Le Vulture did for me. It reminded me that the Shrine of the Black Madonna was in me. And I can do something with it, you know? And so, yeah, that.
Hi, thanks. I just heard on NPR that Amazon is starting its first actual space of a bookshop, which really made me mad. After, and I'm guilty. I've ordered books on Amazon, of course.
Me too.
Okay. But one thing that I think we're all many of our questions are expressing is this concern about after the bookshop. You mentioned the word future, which I appreciated, and I'm wondering to what extent the bookshop could be a kind of hermeneutic, a way of reading and engaging materials that isn't so much a physical space, because you gave us this experience in this room, and I can imagine how you're going to give it to your readers in your book. Yeah. But I also feel that you're, while I want to ask if that's a possibility, because I want that to be a possibility.
The hermeneutic part.
That it's a way of reading and not necessarily a space. Mm-hmm. But I also think that in your talk you were really wedded to the idea that there's something tactile and there are bite marks on So that's...
No, I mean, it is only at this point a hermeneutic, which is also enough. I shouldn't say only, right? Because the Black Queer Bookshop doesn't exist. I don't know of one. You know, I don't know of one. I haven't been to the Shrine of the Black Madonna in, God, like 24 years, you know? It's actually still up and running, you know? But, you know, the question of the bookshop can't hinge on the literalization, you know, of the bookshop. It has to be the hermeneutic, right? Now, what then... am I interested in as the effects of that hermeneutic, right? I am actually interested in, you know, the sort of subjective, you know, effects of the hermeneutic, like producing different types of subjects, right? You know, who, you know, also have a, you know, at the very foundation, it is about a literacy, you know, what books and what things, what music, what art, what did it do for you? What are you collecting in your head? You know, what kind of bookshop are you producing, right? Which for me is a critical question. It's not simply a question about acquisition, right? You know, so no, not the literalization of the bookshop, but, you know, and this is the part about the aesthetics as the mode to produce both subjectivity and also institutionality, right? What kind of world are you going to produce as you've been arrested, affected by the bookshop, you know? You know, what kind of advisor are you going to be, you know, to, you know, that student that wants to develop, you know, that undergrad who wants to develop a project around, you know, Black diaspora or queerness and sexuality, right? You know, what kind of method are you going to try and, you know, at least assemble for folks, for also for them to sort of rearrange, you know, who are working under the moniker of Black Queer Studies, you know? So what kind of institutional practice is the sort of subjective transformation going to yield? You know, it doesn't have to be a bookshop. It can be a bookshop. If you have a bookshop, I will go to the bookshop. But, you know, it has to be a different way of imagining and doing community, right? Like, you think here of, you know, there's a passage in that I use quite a bit in Derrida's Eyes of the University, in the reorder of things, I use it quite a bit, where he says that every poem, every math equation, every syllabus, you know, is a way of imagining an institution, imagining a community, you know, and so that every act of textual production, of artistic production, is also then a way of imagining a socius, a world, you know. So are you going to then use the bookshop in you, you know, to reconsolidate a world or to disrupt the world that you've been given and imagine something new, you know? So yeah, so that's the institutional part, not the literal, you know, the institutional hermeneutical part, okay? Mm-hmm.
Hi, thank you. Hey. That was a great talk. And I was just curious about the question of the future. And I've been wrestling with the very provocative conversation about no future. Mm-hmm. And I was wondering if you could speak to the notion of the archive and the aesthetic and and the possibility of a future, or whether there's still, whether no future is still a possibility for queer of color critique.
No future. I'm gonna say no. You know, and I'm gonna say it because, look, you know, politics is always a fraught venture, okay? But it's always a necessary venture. I mean, that's what you will hear from me. You know, so that then, you know, the sort of engagement with temporality is not something one can absent oneself from out of sheer will. So that, like, you know, I mean, it's sort of like that old, you know, sort of observation that founded post-structuralism, right? That, like, you know, you're not going to escape power, so figure out what you're going to do in it, right? And so, you know, that would be my answer in terms of, you know, whether or not you can sort of wave, you know, a futurist politics away. Mm-hmm. I mean, this is also, again, you know, thinking here of deconstruction, you know, and Spivak's, you know, reinterpretation of deconstruction, right? That, like, yes, politics, you know, are contradictory, they're damnable, but you can't help but do it. You know? And so in many ways for me, this is about, you know, producing, you know, a kind of literacy around, all right, then what would be a way of doing it that would, best as we could, avoid, you know, the catastrophes, right? You know, because it's sort of like, example, my first formation, Shrine of the Black Madonna again, my first formation, critical formation, was Black nationalism. Mm? Now, everyone knows that I am a critic of black nationalism. But it's not like I can just wave it away, right? So in fact, this is kind of what the bookshop, this is part of the metaphor of the bookshop, that like it is actually part of a critical tradition that it oftentimes objects to. But there are also, you can't deny that there are elements of it in your DNA, right? And then so, by what calculus am I going to filter out the things that are useful about this thing that I have spent so much time critiquing, right? And I mean, this all applies to the question of like futurity, because it is really about the question of, you know, what is the possibility of being a political subject, you know? And, you know, for me, you know, I'm a deconstructivist in that way, right? You know? I mean, in this, you know, Spivakian sense, like, you know, you're not gonna get away from, you know, articulating some relationship to the future in the same way you're not gonna get away from oxygen unless you're dead, you know? Yeah.
Hello. I wondered if you could speak a little bit more about the collection of institutions that individuals and communities carry with them.
Oh, yeah.
And sort of the place of visibility,
yeah,
or
yeah, yeah,
a product that that individual or community is then tasked to do something with?
Oh, uh-huh. Yeah, you know, this is actually something that first occurred to me when I was working on my last book. You know, and I don't talk about this instance in the book, but there's a way in which, you know, it really shaped that book in terms of my understanding. I mean, you know, I'll tell you the story first. So, you know, when I went off to college, my paternal grandfather would say to me every time, still stay Roderick, you know? And that was his thing, still stay Roderick. Because, you know, he was one of those black parents, black working class parents who had sent his kids off to college, and some of them came back as strangers, you know, unrecognizable. And he didn't say significant, he didn't say don't go. You know, he said, still stay Roderick. And so I thought about that, you know, as I was writing the reorder of things, because in fact, what he was saying, that even though I've never been to a university except for my children's graduation, I never sat in, you know, a university classroom, I only went to the fourth grade, there was a way in which the university was in my house, you know? And I was observing what it was doing to, I mean, use these words, to the subjectivity of my kids. You know, so the institution was in my grandparents' house. It, you know, it was heterotopic in that way because he also saw it in his kids' lives, you know, to an extent where it didn't, you know, he didn't recognize them, you know, and so he was saying to me that, you know, you will have this wonderful opportunity, right? But know that, you know, being in an institution is almost like a diet, you know, and you've got to figure out how to metabolize, you know, the institution itself, you know, and, you know, and so I would say that that goes for every, you know, institution, right? And also the ones that we, you know, will dream up. You know, like, you know, to think about, okay, the kind of worlds that we're creating, you know, in our classroom, through our reading habits, through the writing. You know, it was very important for me, for instance, to use my first book, Aberrations, to, you know, really get people to think about what it would mean to approach not just queer of color critique, but also women of color feminism, you know, as a legitimate and institution with ever-renewing possibilities of new thinking, new articulations, you know. And also, you know, queer of color critique. Like, I, you know, I don't know that I would have imagined that, like, you know, it would be institutionalized in the way that it has become institutionalized and stuff. You know, a lot of which I like, most of which I like. You know, but that's also the hazard, right? That you can't control entirely, you know, the institutions that you invoke, you know, or that you sort of put into being, you know, which also means then that you sometimes, you know, work against the aspects of those institutions that you, you know, put the pedal on.
All right, well, please join me in thanking our speaker again for such an amazing conversation.
Thank you.